Laparoscopic tissue approximation technique. Today we will start the extracorporeal knotting, and before that I am just going to present one a small PowerPoint, that is the laparoscopic tissue approximation technique. Imagination is more important than knowledge. It was said by Albert Einstein. Especially in laparoscopy, according to the diameter of the tissue, according to tensile strength, according to your port position and ergonomics, you have to decide that which type of tissue approximation will be appropriate for this surgery. In open surgery, we don't have the problem of access. So generally, by just asking the assistant who is standing on the opposite side of table, he can help you to approximate the tissue, and then you will have a lot of manipulation by your beautiful hand, and approximation is not an issue. But in laparoscopy, one of the major problem is tissue approximation. Initially, once the laparoscopy was started, at that time titanium clip was the only method of tissue approximation, because cholecystectomy was one of the initial first surgery which was very popular, and to clip the cystic duct and cystic artery, people were using the titanium clip. And still it is most widely used approximation technique in by laparoscopic surgeon. If you are using titanium clip, you should take care that the clip applicator should always be kept under vision, because if with the loaded clip it will hit any organ, then it can damage the organ also, and you can lose the clip also. You can lose the clip also inside the abdomen. It should be kept perpendicular to the structure, and both the clip, both the limb of the clip applicator should be visible, because in laparoscopy your vision is restricted and you have two dimensions. So if both the limb of the clip applicator you will not see, then accidentally you can clip any structure behind, and that will be sometime dangerous. When you clip, then it should encircle first, and after that you can bring it little up or little down. Distance between two clips should be 3 millimeter, and distance between the sacrifice clip should be 6 millimeter. You should keep the clip applicator pressed at least for 3 to 5 seconds, so that there should be a plastic deformation of the structure. And then before pulling the applicator, you should disengage the limb. Like after opening the clip applicator, immediately you should not pull the clip. First you open the clip applicator and go up or down, so it will disengage the clip, and then you bring it out. Because sometime if there is a blood clot or if there is some particle lodged over the limb of the clip applicator, it will stuck with the clip, and if you are directly pulling, your clip will be loose. We should also confirm a good dumbbell formation. If it is a good dumbbell formation, that means your clip is nicely applied. In this picture we can see that both the limb of the clip applicators are visible. But here only one limb of the scissors is visible, another limb is not visible, and it may bite the artery behind. So either clip or scissors, whatever the structure you use, both the limbs should be ideally visible. Our clip completely safe. Previously it was thought it is very safe, but cat eye stone has already been reported. Those are the cystic duct clip stone. So that's why knotting and suturing is the best method of tissue approximation. And especially if you want to avoid the cat eye stain or cystic duct clip stone in a dilated cystic duct, then knotting and suturing of the cystic artery is important. How to apply the knot on cystic duct and cystic artery, that I will demonstrate to you in the operation theater also. But why laparoscopic surgeons are reluctant to knot? If you see the laparoscopic surgeon, even though if they are very skilled and a lot of experience, but generally once the question comes with the knotting and suturing, then generally they are reluctant. They want some ready-made material, some tacker, some staplers, some clips or energy. Reason is, it is a time-taking procedure. Sometimes we have lack of confidence on our knot, interrupted practice, improper selection of knot type, improper technique of knotting, difficult hand-eye coordination, long cylindrical instruments, two-dimensional vision, and poor ergonomics. These are the factors why generally surgeons are reluctant towards the knotting and suturing. There are two types of knot. One is called as extracorporeal, another is called as intracorporeal. Extracorporeal means you will tie the knot outside and then you will push it in with the help of a knot pusher. That will be called as extracorporeal knot. Most commonly used extracorporeal knot all over the world is Roeder's knot, Meltzer's knot, Tayside knot, or tumble square knot. That is also called as a square knot also. Now, most common intracorporeal suturing. In intracorporeal, what we will do? We will drop the needle and suture inside the abdomen, just like open surgery. And with the help of the needle holder, we have to suture the structure. That is intracorporeal. Most common intracorporeal knots are surgeon's knot, a square knot, tumble square knot, Dundee jamming knot, and Aberdeen termination. And one by one, we will learn all these type of knots during our course. Now, suture material. For a small tubular structure like appendix, like fallopian tube, fimbriel end of the tube, you can use catgut also. But it should be dry chromic catgut. What is the meaning of dry? That you should not drop this catgut for couple of minutes over the tissue, because it will rest on the tissue, it absorbs the water and it swells. And after that, if you slide it, outer surface will be peeled off and it breaks. So you should immediately apply the knot once you go with the endo loop. Endo loop is an instrument which is made by the Johnson & Johnson, Ethicon. They are selling it also, pre-tied loop, that is called as endo loop. And most of the time, it is made up of catgut. Catgut is nowadays seldom used elsewhere. In those situations, PDS is a good alternative, that is monofilament polygalactane material, and that can be used for the extracorporeal knot. For intracorporeal, you should not use any structure, any suture material which has memory. Some of the suture materials has memory. Memory means this is memory. If I am bending it, it is becoming a straight its own. So any suture material which has memory should not be used for the intracorporeal knot. Like PDS is not good for intracorporeal. Catgut is not good. Proline is not good. Nalin is not good. For those, Vicryl is better. And in Vicryl also, white Vicryl is good. That is, Ethicon is making by the name of Rapi Vicryl. And another Gore-Tex company is making by the name of Gore-Tex. This white color has the advantage that even in the bloody field, it will be easily visible because it reflects the light. So suppose you are ligating the uterine artery, or if you are ligating the renal artery, at that time everywhere the reddish environment is there. And if your suture material is white, immediately it will reflect the light and you will be easily able to catch the tail of the suture and tie the knot. So white color should be preferred. Sometimes you want the interrupted suturing or permanent suture material. In those situations, you can use either Dacron or silk. Dacron is polyester. And polyester is one of the strongest suture material available. Permanent suture material is required in some of the reconstructive surgery. Like suppose you want to do sacrocolpopexy, birch suspension, rectopexy, fundoplication. In those situations, absorbable suture we cannot use. In that, Dacron is a good alternative. And if you want a cheaper alternative, then you can use silk also. But compared to silk and Dacron is better, because silk, although it is cheaper, but sometime reaction has been reported because it is a biological material, and that's why it should be Dacron and polyester is completely inert. It doesn't react any time. Now, stages of knotting, it is important to remember, that knot is either exactly right or hopelessly wrong. It is never nearly right, especially in laparoscopy. When we tie a knot, it should be either exactly right or hopelessly wrong. And if you want to tie a beautiful knot, then it should be, have the correct configuration, correct shaping, and correct drawing. Means if the knot has not correct shape, correct configuration, and correct locking, then it is hopelessly wrong. How to get a correct configuration and correct drawing, that we will discuss in afternoon after lunch. We will start your extracorporeal knotting, and then I will demonstrate you in the lab that how to get a exact configuration, exact shape, and exact securing. Now the first knot we are going to discuss today is the Roeder's knot. You know, the Roeder was the first surgeon who has used this knot. But we should never think that knots are only invented by the surgeons. Actually, knots were first invented by the mountaineers, shipmen, and the weavers. There is one Ashley. Ashley was a mountaineer. Ashley has written one Ashley book of knot, and Ashley is considered as father of knotting and suturing. And in his encyclopedia, he has described thousands, 11 years of the work he has published, and he has 7,000 illustrations and 3,800 type of knot he has described. So any knot which you will think about, it is already present in the Ashley book. What we are wearing these cloths, what is this? This is knot. And different pattern of the knotting gives you the different texture and different design of your cloth. So knotting and suturing, surgeons are doing very less, but the weavers, mountaineers and shipmen, they play a lot with the different type of knotting. I have written one book, that is the Mastering the Technique of Laparoscopic Knotting and Suturing. In the USA, it is by the McGraw-Hill. In India, it is published by the JP Brothers. And in this book, I have tried to put all the knotting and suturing, which is recommended and which is laparoscopically better. So I am going to discuss the first knot today, is the Roeder's knot. And Roeder was the first surgeon who has used catgut to tie this knot for appendicectomy. Configuration of Roeder's knot is 1-3-1. 1-3-1. That is, you will take one hitch, three wind, and one half knot. That's why it is called as 1-3-1. And you can use it for the catgut also, or any multi-filament you can use. So suture length will be two length of suture will be used. If you have to tie a free structure is like appendix, fimbriel end of the tube, or a loose omentum, then the suture length should be minimum 75 centimeter. If you want to do continuous structure, like this is continuous structure, like uterine artery, splenic artery, renal artery, cystic artery, in those situations, minimum suture length should be 90 centimeters. So suppose this is a 75 centimeter suture, then you will ask your assistant for finger. And you have two limbs, one is short limb, other is long limb. And then you will encircle the suture, and then you will cross the hand. Now shorter is above the longer, and then you will go from below, and this is single hitch is taken. This is single hitch is taken. After that, you will take three wind. Wind means encircling the two limbs. And three wind will be taken. This is first wind. And then you will put the second wind. And then you will put the third wind. So three wind will be taken. And then one half knot will be taken on the one side of the limb. This is one half knot which will be taken on the one side of limb. And this is 1-3-1. And this is the Roeder's knot which is ready. After tying the Roeder's knot, now you can easily slide it with the help of the knot pusher and it is very secured up to 8 to 12 millimeter of the diameter of the structure, and it can be beautifully applied. But roeder's knot is not good for the monofilament. Roeder's knot was very good for catgut because catgut swells and it becomes very strong. Nowadays catgut is seldom used. We are using the monocreel or PDS. In those situations, Meltzer was one surgeon who has modified this roeder's knot, and it is called as Meltzer's knot. Or in some of the book, they are describing it as a modified roeder's knot. Only difference between the Meltzer's and roeder's is that roeder is 131 and Meltzer is 232. So you will, this is short limb, this is long limb, and two hitches will be taken first. You will go from below up, and this is one hitch you will take, and after that you will take the second hitch. So two hitches will be taken first, followed by three wind. This is first wind, then this is second wind, and then this is third wind. And then two half knot will be taken on the same side of the limb. This is one half knot, and this is second half knot, and then it is done. And then now you will push it with the help of the knot pusher, and that is called as Meltzer's knot. Now, in these knots, there is one problem. In roeder's and Meltzer's knot, there is one inherent problem. What is that problem? That sometime when you are tying this knot, it gets elongated. What is elongation? That suppose this is the knot here, and this is the suture, and if you are coming like this, and you are taking the hitch, and then you are going for wind. This is first wind, this is second wind, this is third wind. Sometimes these wind may get elongated. And if it is elongated, if it is not stacked properly, stacked means how you are stacking your coins or how you are stacking the playing card, then it may be loose. Other problem is overriding. Sometimes what happens that this knot which you have taken, this is the first wind, and second comes over the first, and third comes over the second, and then when you are taking the hitch, it will be loose because it is overriding. And third problem is sometime if you have done, this is your first wind, and then this is first hitch, then this is first wind, this is second wind, this is third wind, and when you lock it, it may get loose here, last lock. To overcome these problems, we have just modified one knot, and that is called as Mishra's knot. If you see this knot, in these two, three problems doesn't happen. And in this knot, this is also a beautiful extracorporeal knot. You will take the suture, you will ask your assistant to keep the finger. This is your shorter limb, this is your longer limb. And then you will keep on locking after every hitch. So there is no chance of overriding, and there is no chances of elongation. So this is first hitch is taken, just like roeder's, and this is single hitch. After that, you will take one wind. This is one wind. And after one wind, again you will take one half knot. So idea is that that wind cannot get elongated, and it cannot get override. Then you will take again second wind. And after second wind, again you will take one half knot. And then you will take the third wind. And then you will take the last half knot. Now it is done. So if you see carefully, it cannot be stacked. It has to be stacked. It cannot be elongated, and it cannot be overridden. And then you can push it with the help of the knot pusher. So this knot also is one of the good knot which you can learn. If you will see the suture material, it is same as of Meltzer. In the Meltzer, what is there? First, there is two hitches, and the last, there is a two lock. So altogether four lock is there, but here instead of the first two, there is only one, and instead of two lock, here there is three lock. So altogether suture material is there, and this is tensile strength is more, and we have practically demonstrated that this knot may be useful up to 22 millimeter of the structure, like in cases of inverse ligation in the cholecystectomy or sometime partial cholecystectomy where you want to tie a knot at the level of the neck of the gallbladder, it can be used. So once more I will demonstrate you that same way you will hold the sauter above the lunger, and then this is the one hitch, single hitch is taken first, followed by one wind. So configuration is 1-1-1-1-1, and that is the first wind, and then again you will take one half knot. This is one half knot, and again you will take one more wind. This is one more wind, and then you will take one more half knot, and then third wind, and again one more half knot. So it is very easy, and advantage is that even the there is no in Meltzer what is there, all the half knots are at the end, but here it is alternative. So if you will see very carefully, it is more stacked, and this stacking here, if you will see the knot, it is more stacked, and due to that stacking, it doesn't have the overriding and it doesn't get elongated, and then you can use it to push with the knot pusher. So these are the different type of knots which you can use in the extracorporeal. Now Meltzer knot is the most popular knot all over world, that is a modified Roeder's knot, and that already you know it is 232. Sometime this is already I have demonstrated. Sometime there is a T-square knot. Tayside knot is one of the knot which is very popular for the silk, in which what you have to do, a single hitch is taken. This is Tayside. Tay, what is Tay? Tay is a river in the UK. And you will take one hitch above, and then you will take three wind below. You will not take over the two limbs. This is one wind, then this is second, and then this is third below, and then you will take a half knot in between first hitch and first wind. This is first hitch and first wind, you will take a half knot, and this is a Tayside knot. Tayside knot is a beautiful knot, especially if you are using silk or other braided material, because it slides in spite of having the braided appearance. And this is Tayside knot. It is particularly useful where you are using the non-absorbable suture, like in cases of sometime bird suspension or the crural approximation in cases of fundoplication, and this is called as Tayside knot. Then you have the other, that is a tumble square knot. How it is? Tayside, you want to see again? Yes, I will show you just Tayside. This is Tayside knot. So again, your assistant will have the finger, and after that you will take, this is a smaller limb is left side, longer limb is right side, and cross the hand same way. Don't worry, this is not once you will practice you will be master, one by one we will practice. And this is single hitch is taken, and after that instead of going to the above, you will come down, and the winds has to be taken on the single thread. This is the first wind, then you will take the second wind, then you will take the third wind, and then locking has to be taken in between the first hitch and first wind. If you see, there is a groove here, and through this groove you are locking. You will not lock here, you will lock here in between the first hitch and first wind. So you will take it from below up, and then you will take a half knot, that is a locking knot, and then this is called as Tayside knot. And once it is done, then you will bring the first hitch nearer, and it is ready, and then with the help of the knot pusher you can push it in. These all videos are there in your member area, and if you want you can download all those videos. So this was called as Tayside knot. That is also very popular knot. Now the next knot is called as tumble square knot. Tumble word means falling straight. In those situations you can just take a suture and then you can take a half knot. This is one half knot, and after that you can take the second half knot below. And if you will see very carefully, these are the two half knot. If you see very carefully, this thread and this thread is same thread. And if you see this thread and this thread is same thread. Why? If you see this thread, right now it is on the right side, but it is coming to the left, and again it is coming to the right. So actually, if you will see the continuously this thread, this goes like that. So right side of the thread becomes right, left side of the thread becomes left, and then you will tighten it. After tightening it, you will pull the same side of the thread. Like if you want to slide on the right, you will tumble it. Tumbling word is very important. These two threads are same and these two threads are same. And then you will tumble it. Tumble means making a straight. And as soon as you will make it a straight, it will start sliding over. And this is called as tumble square knot. It will beautifully slide. And this knot has a capacity to tolerate the structure which is under tension. And it is slide. And after that, you will lock once more. First, you have to untumble. Untumble means you will pull both the end of the suture and automatically it will convert now into a square knot. Now it is called as untumbling. After that, it cannot come back. It is very secure. And finally, you will lock it with one half knot. So this is one of the knot which is very popular, especially in the hiatus hernia surgery or myomectomy, where you have the muscle and spread it a lot and it has a lot of tension. In those you can use tumble square knot. Roeder's knot also, whenever you are using for continuous structure, you have to ask your assistant to put a finger over the cannula and then you need to tie the knot. So assistant finger, especially for continuous structure, because for continuous structure you have to go with the suture all the way, encircle it and bring it out. And then you will tie the knot and then you will push it with the help of the knot pusher. There are different type of thread introducers and cobbler's needle which also can be used for tying the intracorporeal knots and sometimes extracorporeal. In laparoscopy, whenever you have to use needle, endoesky needle is the best and the most intuitive needle used in laparoscopic surgery. What is esky? Esky is a sports which the people play on the ice, isn't it? They stand on the ski and skiing, it is called as skiing. And it is just like a ski shape. And the players, they stand and this ski will slide on the ice. In the winter, many people, they play the skiing game. And this is same ski shaped. And if you see the distal one third is curve and proximal two-third is straight. Endoesky needle is the most intuitive needle in the laparoscopic surgery. Why? Because why we use curve needle? Curve needle has the advantage that it can take a bite over the same plane. Suppose you want to suture my two fingers, you need curve needle. A straight needle will not do. And what is the advantage of a straight needle? A straight needle has the advantage that pulling the needle out is easy. So endoesky needle will give you the advantage of curved needle as well as straight needle. It is easy to manipulate inside the abdomen, easy to handle and less traumatic. Curved needle, sometimes complete half circle curved needle, cannot hide into the reducer. And if you want to put into the abdomen, it is hard. Although the ways are there, by that technique, you can put the half circle curved needle also inside the abdomen. But endoesky needle is easily can go even up to 35 mm needle directly through the cannula. You can introduce hiding inside the reducer. And it is easy to manipulate. Curved needle, sometimes when you are pulling out, it can hook the bobble and can perforate the bobble. But endoesky needle cannot do that. and it is very secure, very conformatory, and it is easy to manipulate inside the abdomen. So this is the endoskin needle, which is maximally used. And how you can use the needle? Generally, the suture size should be 8 to 12 centimeter and 20 centimeter maximum. And endoskin needle you will use. And first you will drop the needle inside the abdomen. So, just once you will drop the needle inside the abdomen, then you will start making the surgeon's knot. And what, how to make the surgeon's knot? It is a very easy. Just first I am showing you on the tissue. It is very easy. Just you drop the needle like that. The tip is on the left side, tail is on the right side, and press it. As soon as press, automatically needle is inclined. Then you will take a bite. This is the bite taken, and you can see it is endoskin needle, so easily it will come out. You don't have to rotate. And after that, you have to make a C-shaped. This is a shape of a C. And then right, left hand instrument will be static, and right will take two winds. And then you will hold it, and it is tightened. And this is the first knot, that is called as surgeon's knot. After that, you will make a reverse C. This is not make a C. If it is a C, it is wrong. And then it will be a reef knot. So you have to make reverse C. How to make it? Just you reverse it and it becomes a reverse C. Now right hand will be a static and left will take a single wind. Surgeon's knot configuration is 2-1-1. First time two wrap followed by single opposite alternating wrap. First time two wrap and followed by single opposite alternating wrap. So this is the last wrap and this is complete. This is called as surgeon's knot. Surgeon's knot is one of the most important intracorporeal knot in laparoscopic surgery, because if you have to do the tubal recanalization, or if you have to do the bowel perforation or bladder injury, in those situations, repair to those injury, only the surgeon's knot is practical. Extracorporeal knot can only be used for tough structure like vaginal vault or myoma, but for bowel or tube, you have to use the intracorporeal suturing. Again, we will see how to do. Here you will take the bite, and just after taking the bite, hold the needle by left hand and then guard the tissue and pull it out. After that, you will make a shape of a C. This is just like a C. And left hand will take, and two winds will be taken by the right hand, and then you will catch the tail. But you don't pull the tail. If you pull the tail, you go to jail. So tail should be only pulled at the end. In the beginning, if you will pull the tail, it will be completely reversed. It will become reef knot. So tail should not be pulled in the beginning. You should not make a shoe lashing also. Shoe lashing, if it is making, it is bad. So it should be away. Both the knots should be away. And now you will tighten it. And this is first time double wrap. After that, you will take a reverse C. This is a reverse C. And then you will take a single wrap. This is just a single wrap. And then catch the tail. And don't pull in the beginning. In the beginning, keep it loose and then tight it only at the end, so that it will not be loose. And then we have the last C. This is the last C, and then this way you will perform. So surgeon's knot, we will practice later and we will show you how to do in the laparoscopy. Like suppose you have any perforation or any injury, then surgeon's knot is often used in the laparoscopic surgery. Like just I will show you here, there is a small perforation which I have shown you earlier. Then here there is a perforation, and this is endoskin needle. And this endoskin needle is also marketed by the Johnson & Johnson. Johnson & Johnson is selling also. But you can make your own also. You can make your own surgeons, your endoskin needle, by tapering the needle and making the proximal 2/3 straight, distal 1/3 curve. So this is intestinal perforation, and this is surgeon's knot. And here this is the first wrap, this is the second wrap, and then you can catch the tail. Here is the tail. and then slowly you will slide it by the right hand and drop the needle and then slide it. In this way it is tightened. Interrupted suture is given here and this is done. And then again you will take a reverse C and you will suture. So intracorporeal surgeon's knot is very important knot which any surgeon has to learn. And this is now reverse C and you will take the tail and slowly you will slide it. Sometime you can use two needle holders also and sometime you can use one needle holder and one Maryland. It is, and again you will take one more C. So this way surgeon's knot can be used. Detail we will learn and we will practice once we will start in the different suturing. Now tumble square intracorporeal knot. Sometime intracorporeal also tumble square you can tie. How? We will see here that this is same endoski needle which you will drop inside the abdomen and then you will take two bites. This is one bite taken at this level. Pull it out and suppose another tissue is far away. It is far away here. Like for myomectomy or for giant perforation of duodenum and here. Now we can see these two tissues are far away, isn't it? And surgeon's knot will not be possible because your assistant finger is not sitting over the knot or your assistant is not holding the knot with the artery forceps. So how to approximate it? For that you can use the intracorporeal tumble square knot. How to use it? Pull it out and then take a single wrap. That is a single wrap will be taken and this is the first part of a square. Keep it loose, don't tight it. And then make a reverse C and this is the second wrap. So two wrap will be taken and this is called a square knot. After that, this and this thread is same thread. And this thread is same thread. So we want to slide over the needle end, so we make it tumbled. So you can hold it and you will pull it. And this is called as tumbling. And after tumbling, it is ready to slide. And beautifully it can slide and it can approximate. Now it is approximated. See here, these two tissue which was far away is approximation. And this is called as buttock sign. This is one buttock. This is another buttock. Buttock sign means it is already nicely under tension. You can see the tension over the tissue also. This is a beautiful knot and you can very nicely approximate after doing myomectomy. And then this is called as untumbling. Now this is again locked. As soon as you will pull both the end, it is called as untumbling. And then you can finally lock it. For final lock, again you will make one C and then lock it so that it will not come again back. So this tumble square knot is a beautiful knot which is used for the tissue under tension and it gives you the buttock sign. That is important to see. That means your tension is good, tension is accurate. Again once more I will show you. This is the suture. You will drop the suture in such a way that tip of the needle should be left, tail of the needle should be, and press. Automatically it will get aligned. As soon as you will press by the upper jaw, it is aligned. And then you will take the one bite. See, we are taking far away. Just to show you the power of this knot. This is one tissue away and another bite here. So that it is far away. Surgeon's knot will not work. And tumble square will do very nicely. So these are the two structures far away from each other. And you want to approximate it. Just like crural approximation during the fundoplication or myomectomy or sometime in the various surgery. And now you will make a C and this is a half knot. Only half knot is taken, only one wind, not two wraps. And this is the first part of the square knot. Then you will make a reverse C and this is the second part of a square knot. So both has to be approximated nearer to each other. And then you will do tumbling. How to do tumbling? Hold this suture and hold that suture and pull it. As soon as you will pull, it is tumbled now. Now it is tumbled. And after tumbling, it is ready to slide. And just take a left hand Maryland and slide it. And here it is nicely giving you the again buttock sign. And it is approximated. So dead space somewhere, suppose in laparoscopy some dead space has been created, or you want to approximate that, in those situation this is the tumble square knot, which is very effective and very good. And some tricks are there, some that we will practice during the in the lab during the suturing and knotting, because many things cannot be described on the book or in the videos. Those tricks we will hold your hand and we will discuss with you during the suturing and knotting, because every surgeon has their own problems, and carefully that problem has to be rectified during the laparoscopy. See here how much tension is there, entire tissue is building up but it cannot come out. So this way tumble a square. Then comes the Dundee jamming knot and Aberdeen termination. This is also a beautiful knot which can be used for the laparoscopic intracorporeal suturing. Dundee jamming knot and Aberdeen termination is used for continuous suturing. Sometimes you have to suture the peritoneum, and in those situation you will use this. So this is a beautiful knot, and you can drop the suture same way after making a starter knot. How to make the Dundee jamming knot, that we will demonstrate you in the lab. So this is a knot already made, pre-made knot, and then you will take a bite. This knot is very useful for inguinal hernia surgery and to repair the serosal surface of the uterus after myomectomy, serosal layer. And this is a starter knot, and as soon as you will pull the suture, automatically it gets locked. You don't have to make a C and reverse C, and now it is, as soon as you pull it, now it is automatically locked. And after that, you will keep on taking a continuous suturing, just like the mattress suture or the blanket suture, which is used in the open surgery. Even in the open surgery, when you close the peritoneum, you are taking continuous suturing, because interrupted suturing, peritoneum cannot tolerate. It will tear. And that's why always bring the needle from within the C. So automatically it will get locked. And here it is getting locked. And keep on taking these bites. So this is a beautiful knot which is used as a continuous suturing, especially in cases where the peritoneum is there. And you will drop this needle inside the C. And then again take a bite, automatically it will get locked. Distance between two sutures is approximately 10 mm. In the peritoneum, you don't need to go very near, and keep on taking at 10 mm. So your time is also not wasted unnecessarily. Peritoneum doesn't need to be very tight, because peritoneum just approximated, because transmigration and metamorphosis automatically regenerate the peritoneum or the serosa. Sometimes this knot is also useful for the gastric plication, in which after doing the inner layer suturing, you can outer continuous suturing you can do. It is also for the bladder perforation, or sometime for the vesicovaginal fistula, or sometime for peritonization after the sacrocolpopexy. When you put the mesh and you fix the mesh with the anterior longitudinal ligament to the sacral promontory, then you have to hide this mesh with this beautiful continuous suturing. And laparoscopically it is very good. And see now, that much is sutured. Now we will see how to terminate. If you want to terminate it, that will be done by the Aberdeen termination. Just one more, I think one more bite will be taken here. So this is one more bite. It is locked. And now you can terminate. During termination, don't make a C. It should be without a C, and take a bite on the healthy tissue, not on the interatomy. On the healthy tissue, and then bring loop within loop. go through here and pull a loop, just like how you do the abutting termination in open surgery. And you'll put a loop, and then again you go, make this loop shorter, and again you go through the loop, and again you make a loop. So this is loop within loop, and pull the non-needle end. This is non-needle end. And ultimately you go and take the needle out. And here it will be done. So this is loop within loop. And ultimately, as soon as you will pull it, it will get automatically locked and needle is out. Sometimes, some people, they take three loop. So loop within loop within loop. And if you are making three loop, take care, needle should not come out. Yes. Isn't it? And pull only the non-needle end. And now last, you take the needle out. So this is a abutting termination. It is just like open surgery also you are doing, and it is locked. So this is Dundee jamming knot, continuous suturing, and different type of suturing combination. Sometime you can start with the surgeon's knot and you can terminate with the abutting termination. Sometime start with a tumble square and terminate with the abutting termination. So this is Dundee jamming, continuous suturing, and abutting termination. So these are all type of knotting. We will, one by one, we will learn, and then we will see how it works. Don't worry, we will see that again. Now sometime when you go, missed needle should be avoided. Needle should not be missed inside. So laparoscopic knotting and suturing need to learn on the simulator or animal only. Do you know why? Because you cannot learn the laparoscopic suturing and knotting on the patient. Because if patient doesn't need, unnecessarily you don't apply suturing somewhere, isn't it? You will not apply suturing the bowel of the patient if patient doesn't need. And when the patient need it, at that time we don't have sufficient practice. So that's why you should have one endo trainer at your home, and you should keep on practicing this knotting and suturing every day, at least 15 minutes, twice or thrice a week if you will do. Then within 1 month, all the knotting will be your child play. You will put it and you will start knotting spontaneously. So how to do that we will learn and we will see.